far for the biopsy on her eye. Claude and Joyce, who's got a, what do you call, colonoscopy. And remember Sister Jewel, she needs our prayers.
Amen. Sister Emma.
My daughter, she had surgery in the morning at 8.
Amen. Yes, ma'am. Also, Paula goes back for a checkup on her legs. She's been out of work since August, and she's going to be going back to figure out, see what the doctor has to say about that. Brother Donald, is he still away? Is he traveling, coming back?
He's on our street right now.
Okay. Well, thank God for traveling today. Sister Dishon.
Brother, one I'd like y'all to
still
remember, Johnny. She went back to the doctor, and she don't have COVID. Or
nothing like that, but
they cannot find out why her fever keeps spiking. They ran more tests, but so far
they have
nothing come back positive.
Amen. Amen. Let's remember Johnny tonight. Sister Cheryl.
A good friend of mine in North Carolina lost her husband Sunday. Remember her?
Mm. Yes, amen.
Y'all remember Brian? He's sick.
Remember Brian. Sister Terry?
Must have had a tooth pulled this afternoon, so he's in a good bit of pain. Y'all remember him. Amen. And he's got surgery coming up for a hernia on the 12th of February. He's been covered with valves and muscle.
I mentioned the gentleman that killed himself the other day. Remember that family? And also, I forgot. One of Ward's best friends, her dad, they found her dad dead probably a week ago or so. I'm not sure, I don't remember, I forgot, totally forgot. But remember her, she's the only child, her parents are separated. And I mean, he was only like 51, I think.
Lord have mercy. Well, I'm afraid of that. Continue to remember Tommy.
I go back to the heart doctor and try to.
God is able, church.
Yes.
And we're living in a day that the saints of God need to pray, because the sun rises on the just and the unjust.
Yes.
We live in an ungodly world, and things are happening, and we need to stay bathed in prayer. Amen. Stand with me if you're able.
Remember the youth service Friday night.
Friday night youth service.
6:30.
Yes. Amen. Praise the Lord. Brother Justin, if you would, lead us to the Lord.
Dear Lord.
Spirit.
You're Oh,
Yes.
God, we thank you for your goodness.
Have your way tonight.
Thank you, Lord, tonight for your presence.
Have your way, Lord.
Lord God, the Hesed of God, your divine favor, Lord, over your people, God.
We praise you tonight.
We just give you glory in the house tonight. Father, we just thank you, God, Lord, once again for the honor and privilege to come to your house tonight. And Father, as the man of God comes before us tonight, Lord, we introduce Sean before the congregation, God. He's coming to break the bread of life. And Father, we just pray tonight, God, that as he breaks the bread of life and he speaks your word, God, that you've laid upon his heart, God, that word will go forth, God, and produce fruit, God. And Lord, it'll go forth and accomplish that, God, that you intended to do, Lord.
Yes.
God, we give you the glory and the praise and honor for all that's going to be accomplished here tonight, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, Sean. Have your way.
Praise God. Before I get in the sermon, I do want to, testify, I guess. Good way to put it. We, all the information we've been getting in the last couple weeks here at this church has been kind of, it's not miraculous, it's divine, overlaying each other. And I'm going to read you an excerpt that I gave in one of my devotionals for my class. I don't know if you remember Brother Warren's sermon on Sunday morning. I posted this on Saturday night at like 8 o'clock, and I think it's just good for us to hear this. But I'm bringing this up because what Warren preached on, I have no idea what he was preaching on. But when I laid it out, we're talking about running the race and all of that. And that was actually our discussion for this week of devotional in one of my classes, right? Discipline comes from commitment to what you have set out to do. Now, this is what I'm writing. As believers, our loyalty to Christ should be clear as we live our lives devoted to Him in all that we do. In order to increase our faith, and that's what we're going to talk about a little bit tonight. In order to increase our faith and loyalty to Christ, it is very important that we read and pray and read our Bibles every day. Our God has pursued us, His creation of mankind, who were created in His image, to do what He desires. And if He pursued mankind to come into His family, why do we say that so many believers fail to pursue Him in return? Of course, we can't love like God does, nor does He require works, but faith alone. But I believe this. We can be disciplined in our pursuit to follow Christ because we believe He came to forgive us of our sins through His death and resurrection. Because Christ did so much for me, I believe this, and I want to pursue Him and to finish His good race.
Amen.
And I mean this in the honest truth. If you don't remember what Warren preached on, listen to it. Remember that devotion. It is almost, there was three or four points in there that came up on Sunday's message.
Amen.
And I was over there. I didn't know what to do. Stand up, scream, shout. You know, it was amazing to see how the Spirit worked.
Yes.
In a unified body in Christ, which is a big element in Christianity, but I'm not going to get into unity. Tonight, we're going to talk about one story in the Bible, well, two stories. One in the biggest, it's going to be the big part of the sermon, but talking about blind faith. So I'm going to ask you to stand. I'll be reading out of ESV, but we're coming from Mark 10, 46 to 52. And they came to Jericho. And as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples, speaking of Jesus, in a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he had heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "Rabbi, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way.
Amen.
To reading of God's word. There is a lot to unpack here. There's some deep theology, but I'm not going to overwhelm you tonight. I'm going to talk from my heart. There's some... When you look at a crowd, sometimes you wonder why you want to speak it, but there's a reason for it. And faith is the core foundation of Christianity. All right? Faith, in the definition, is a reliance and a trust in God. And it, like I said, is our central focus point, Christianity.
Yes.
All right? But what I bring out in faith, though, or talk about faith, remember that there's many religions that believe that have faith in order to be what you call good, righteous, all these things. So I asked a question, I asked Sister Luke earlier, but it's one of those questions. Why do you think Christianity is different? And a lot of people haven't sat to ponder that thought very, very long.
That's right.
But a lot of religions believe there has to be a faith in a God above. You have the Jews, you have the Islams, they all believe in a God. There's other religions that have faith in other deities. But why is Christianity unique? And I'm talking about Judaism and Islam. They believe in the God of Abraham, which is the God of the Christians, right? But what's the difference? The difference is the pursuit of God to mankind.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
So the Jews, they got the law. They got all the commandments, all the do this, do that, do that. Do the sacrifices, you'll be forgiven, all this other stuff. And of course, now that there's no temple, there's other laws that came out from that. And then you got Islam, same thing, where you have to do these things, you got to do good works. In the Bible, we see it many times, it's not by your works, church.
That's right. It is solely by your faith alone. Amen.
That grants you salvation.
Amen.
Faith generates works, but it only requires faith that God is who he is.
Come on.
And that he saved us from eternal death.
Yes.
And how did he do that? He did it by coming down as man in the creation that he created to die on a cross. It says in the Bible that God would do that. I mean, how could we do that? Some of us won't even die for our family sometimes, much less a complete stranger.
That's right.
God, and why Christianity is so different, is that God decided to come down incarnate as man to pursue his creation. They were failing him left and right. He created them to be images of God. Genesis 1 reads that, where we were created in the image of God. We are to be his imagers, and he pursued us because we were failing at that so much and so often. He said, I have to completely restore this thing that has gone apart. It has gone completely disarray.
That's
and
right.
He came down for us. Amen. And that's why Christianity is different. There is the same God, but there is a complete wrong way of how to get to him. Christianity proves itself from time and time again throughout the old and the new, how all of it intertwines, how God's plan to restore his humans to be with him and his family. And that's why Christianity is so different. Our God pursues us. He didn't give us only the law to say, follow this law.
He pursued us. He came for us to die on a cross.
That's good.
So that is faith. And that is faith for the Christians, is that we believe God came for us to die
for us on the earth through the man Jesus to save us from sin.
Yes. Amen? So now we're going to talk about this God that's blind. Now think about him. He doesn't have Jesus dead yet. He's still alive, walking around. So he's still in the Jewish law, per se. It's what he's following, okay? So this faith that he has is unique. Unique to some of the Jews around that area, but we're going to see how his faith and how he was blind and how in the world did he even have faith was one of the, it hit me between the eyeballs when I was reading this story one day. I said, this is worth telling people because we are all spiritually blind at one point. And then when we come to faith in God, our eyes are open, our spiritual eyes. So remember, our physical senses, we have them, they're important, right? If you're blind, if you sit there and cover your eyes, how hard is it going to be to walk? Pretty hard, right? If you can't hear, how can you speak? How can you talk? How can you communicate? Through sign language and other things. So you see, when you have issues with a sense, usually takes your other senses to compensate for that or help from others. Matter of fact, I read a book a long time ago. Indians, when they used to hunt, they used to starve themselves. Because what they realized was when they starved themselves, they were hungry. They wanted to taste something. They wanted to smell something. They wanted to eat something. So what did that do? That heightened their senses. Your senses actually compensate each other. You got five of them, so when one lacks, the others have to take up for the compensation. So, It is not fun to lose any of your senses because you have to do that. Your body's going to compensate. Matter of fact, we had a lady named Bree on our trip to Israel this year. I'll tell you this little story. She was hard of hearing. She had hearing aids with like amplifiers. And this is a crazy story because you don't get many people like that in the world. I don't know what the ratio is. But this trip, she was there. And guess what? Two people from Shandon, the group that we go with, Jenny and Miss Alberta, they both are in the deaf and hard of hearing. They knew how to do sign language. So Bree was having a tough time for the first day while we're walking through Jerusalem. Like, well, you know, we could always see her doing this. We didn't know what was going on. She couldn't hear. She couldn't hear with the little earpieces they gave us. When Jenny found out, next thing you know, the whole trip, she's doing the sign language, right? And that helped Bree out so much, retaining, because this is her first trip, retaining so much knowledge that she would have otherwise just missed out because she couldn't hear.
Right.
How much of a blessing it is to have friends, families, whoever else, that will help you if your senses are lacking, right? And now we're going to talk about that in the spiritual sense as well. When we don't have sight, it takes somebody telling us. We don't have spiritual sight. We're blinded. We don't know who Jesus is. We don't know about him. Guess what? To be saved, you have to be what? You got to be told something. So your spiritual ears are going to take in the word of the gospel.
Amen.
They're going to take it in. And as soon as you hear that, as soon as you taste a little bit of salvation, a little bit of his peace, a little bit of his joy and love, you will realize real quick that those blinders go away. And then you're open up to a whole new spiritual world. And the one that is true, one that is pure, one that is perfect in all things. So the senses that this man didn't have, being blind, was difficult for him. He had blind faith, all right? And when I say that, he was blind. He didn't see Jesus not one time until he was healed.
That's right.
During this passage of scripture, we got a couple topics I want to talk about. For one, he called Jesus the Son of David. Now, what does the title Son of David mean? He was part of the kingly lineage. Now, that man had to hear it from somebody somewhere.
That's right.
But to physically speak that out in that time was a clear message that this guy was king, this guy was the ruler, this guy was clearly going to be the Messiah.
That's right.
And they were trying to tell the man to hush up. Don't speak. Don't talk that. The man knew it deep in his heart. He had heard the good things. He had heard what Jesus was doing, and he knew that this had to be the Messiah. He already had the faith in him. It was just a matter of Jesus coming by him at that moment. He was going to take that he was going to take that opportunity to get a hold of Jesus. He let him know, he let the crowd even know, that Jesus was the Son of David. He was the Messianic King prophesied from years and years before. The second part, he speaks on having mercy on me. Of course, mercy is a verb. And in this one, I got this from one of my little Bible dictionaries. This is to have mercy and, more importantly, to have compassion. The basic meaning of this verb has to do with having pity or helping a person in difficult circumstances. This man had the faith of Jesus being who he was, and he asked Jesus to have mercy on me. Even before Jesus heard him, he was crying it out, "Have mercy on me." And I knew Jesus probably understood what was going on even before he got to him. So it can be used to describe displays of mercy, compassion by God and humans. But in this sense, we're talking about Jesus. We're talking about God. Have mercy on me. He knew that God would have mercy on him in that moment. He knew Jesus would have the mercy to save him. So three, it's not only that he cried mercy the first time. Later on, after they told him to hush, he cried it out more. He cried it out louder in some translations. Son of David, have mercy
on me. Yes, he did.
Sometimes our faith is tested. We talked about that a little bit earlier. How many times have you prayed for something and it seems like it ain't getting answered?
Oh,
yeah. How many times has that happened? Do you cry out more? Or sometimes you give up? It might have been 20 years ago. Hell, I don't know if this is ever going to happen. You know, sometimes it takes a little bit of dedication, a little bit more crying out.
Yes.
Your God doesn't fail to hear you.
That's right. Come on.
Think about the Mount of Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 7. I love this part of the scripture. Jesus tells them that if your kid asks you for a piece of bread, you're not going to give them a stone. You're going to give them a piece of bread.
Right.
And if he asks for a fish, you're not going to give them a snake. You're not going to give them a serpent because it's going to hurt them, right? And he said, if you being an earthly individual would be that much for your kids,
yes,
how much more do you think your heavenly Father would be?
Yes, amen. Amen.
Your God, your Father, our Father is listening to you every time you think, every time you speak to him.
That's right.
Amen.
Come on. Come on.
And number four, he threw off his cloak after Jesus requesting him to come to him. It's a weird thing to be throwing off a cloak, because that's their main tunic, if you want to call it. That's what they wore. They did have undergarments. So, in Zechariah chapter 3, I did so much digging for this because there was some kind of message behind this. And I couldn't get into anything except for this. I did a Bible study on the Word, and it brought me to Zechariah 3. And this is exactly, this hit me hard. These are the garments that this guy, this blind man, was getting rid of. Zechariah 3, verses 1 through 5. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire?" Now Joshua was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments, dirty garments. This is the same thing this man was wearing. I promise you, they were dirty. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, "Remove the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "Behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you. I will clothe you with a pure vestment." And I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments. And the angel of the Lord was standing by. Throw away those filthy garments.
Yes.
That cloak that man had, he got rid of them. They were dirty. They were filthy. They were not what God wanted. They were not what he created us to have. He threw away his cloak. That was a big statement for a man to, I mean, that's like me getting rid of this. All I had was my t-shirt and, you know, shorts, and that was all they wore under their garments or his cloak. He threw his cloak away. He knew he was dirty, and he wanted to get that filth away before he came to a holy God, to the Messiah. Amen. Fifth point, came to Jesus blind and apparently without help. Now, that's just reading into the Bible a little bit, but we don't have anything that we see where somebody helped him. So I like to think that he was doing it on his own, you know, little, trying to get to where he was going, trying to get to Jesus. How hard would it be to get to Jesus if you could not see? What I said earlier, it took somebody to speak a little bit for all of us to hear about the goodness of God, right? Come to Jesus, acknowledge him, acknowledge that he is Lord, he is the owner, he is the King, he is the Messiah. Once you acknowledge that, once you get those blinders off, once you get to the point where spiritually walking down the altar, you're still blind, but guess what? Those veils are starting to come off when that happens.
That's right.
When you get rid of that, when you acknowledge that you are failed, that you are flawed, you are blind, you get up and start coming to him, that's when you start to open up. That's when you start to really see what life is all about. That's what the blind man did. I think he did it without help. I think he was in full-out pursuit mode. He didn't care who was in his way. He probably had to hit a couple people too, but... Number six, he gave his petition, all right? Since he finally was able to encounter the Son of David, the Messiah. Isaiah 6, one of my favorite verses in prophecy of Jesus. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. Now this is what Jesus spoke in the synagogue at Nazareth before they kicked him out. But this is the part I want you to remember, all right? He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. You think that guy was brokenhearted? To proclaim liberty to the captives. You think he was bound up with anything? And the opening of the prison to those who are bound. My goodness, that describes that man to a T. He was suffering, he was broken, he was bound up. That's why he threw his cloak off, that's why he wanted Jesus, and he wanted the Messiah. Those things are the reason Jesus came, right? Then it goes on, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn on Zion, to give them beautiful headdresses. Zechariah talking about clothing with a new headdress there. Instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of the mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness in the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified.
Yes, yes.
You talk about the headdress, the oil of gladness from the morning, the garments of praise. I know it for a fact. That miraculous incident where Jesus healed the blind man, I guarantee you, he was screaming and shouting and running, telling everybody he could get a hold of.
That's right.
So in that story, we see how the blind man had faith. He didn't have to see. You don't need sight to have faith.
Amen.
Has anybody seen God physically, face to face? Not many people can say they have, so people will say they do that. But you see what I'm saying? The blind faith is an element of Christianity. And we're going to get to that in a minute.
Amen.
I want to talk about another story. We're talking about the wise men, all right? Y'all remember the wise men, right? All right, they had not seen anything about Jesus. They had not seen miracles. Matter of fact, we still know he was a little baby Jesus still, right? The conduct of the wise men is a striking example of faith, okay? So, astronomy gave them the news, all right? And I say astronomy because this is God's creation. I don't mean astrology, the religion of astronomy. They saw the star. They knew what it was. It was part of God's creation. They saw it. They pursued after it. God's creation showed them that the Messianic King had come. Yes. And in Psalms 19, this is referred to by Paul, but Psalm 19, 1 through 2, the heavens declare the glory of the God, and the sky above proclaim his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. These people back then, they knew astronomy. They knew it well. It was a part of their culture. They saw this random constellation of stars come up. There's many people that talk about it. There's three stars in particular. They were like, whoa, that's really bright. We need to go check that out. And that's what they did. They went and sought after it, and they knew about the star of Bethlehem being prophesied in before. So, for one, they didn't know for sure, but they had faith enough to go search this thing out. They believed in Christ when they had never seen him. They believed that there was something going on. There was a king being born.
Amen.
They didn't know about it.
Amen.
They went to sought it out.
Yes.
But that's not all. They also believed in him when the scribes and Pharisees were unbelieving, even King Herod himself. Mm-hmm. Man, there's a king here? We might need to get rid of this dude. Yeah. He told him to come back, right? I want y'all to come back. Tell me where he's at. The wise men knew better. Through God, told them not to go back to him. They went on their way. But we see that they had faith no matter who was telling them yay or nay. They had faith. King Herod wanted to know for sure because he was going to get rid of this king. It was a threat to him. So we see that they had faith, all right? Even though there was others that were unbelieving. But again, that wasn't all. They also believed in him when they saw him as a little infant or a child. Some people debate that. But he was young enough where he's not a king. He's too young to be a king.
That's right.
Yet they still knew it, all right? And they worshipped him. That's in the scriptures.
Yes.
They worshiped this little infant baby.
Sure.
So, this was a crowning point of their faith. They saw no miracles whatsoever. To convince them, they heard no teachings at all. Not the first one to persuade them. And they beheld no signs of his divinity and his greatness over all things. They didn't see him casting out demons and all that stuff. But guess what they did? They still believed that he was the king. And they still gave him the gift in honor of him.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
They saw nothing but this newborn infant, helpless, weak, needing his mom's care. And that is just like any one of us. If we go out there and see a baby, do you think we would have thought that was Jesus? It's tough. It's tough to think about that. Do we have that kind of blind faith that these people had? Yet when they saw this infant, they believed him, and they saw the divine Savior of the world. So in John chapter 20, verse 27 through 29, Jesus is already risen. He's come back to his disciples. This is where he's talking to doubting Thomas. Then he said to Thomas, put your fingers here and see in my hands and put out your hand and place it in my side. Yeah. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. Thomas didn't have faith. That's why we call him doubting Thomas. Until he saw him risen again, right? This is what Jesus said to him. Have you believed because you have seen me? Yeah. Blessed are those that have not seen and yet have believed.
Amen.
Church, you are blessed people.
That's right.
If you believe in Jesus Christ. You have peace. You have joy. You have love. You have the goodness of God running with you. You have favor of the Lord if you are his child. You have nothing to fear. You have nothing, no anxiety, there's no depression. We can cast our cares on him, and he will take care of us.
Amen.
We can take, he can take Amen. Care of us. We are his children. Blessed are you that have not seen and have believed. Blessed are you. And let's go to 1 Peter now, 1 chapter 3 through 9. It's a little bit lengthy, but it's good. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, thank you, Lord, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Amen. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold and perishes through it, it is tested by fire, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. The revelation of Jesus Christ, where our faith comes in, is that hearing of Jesus Christ, seeing who he was, what his plan was, and why he came for us. Now this is the big part. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressable and filled with glory.
By taking
the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Church, if you've been saved, goodness, we have peace. We have the God who created it all as your Father.
That's right.
You have absolutely nothing to worry about. Matthew 6, 34 through 39, Jesus gives them on the Mount of Beatitudes again. He said, the sparrows eat, right? You see them over there, they got big bellies. They're eating good. The lilies in the field, how beautiful are they? They're clothed better than Solomon. Solomon being the wealthiest and wisest king out there. He said, if you seek after me and my righteousness, all of these things will be added unto you.
Amen. Amen.
When I talked about earlier, my little devotion I gave to him, to that reading, that praying, that seeking out for his righteousness, when you do those things, your faith will start to expound on itself day after day after day.
Yes.
Amen. This is what Peter is talking about. You don't have to see to believe. And blessed are those that believe when they don't see. And then we go to 2 Corinthians 5, 6, and 7. So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. While we're here on earth, we're away from the Lord. But guess what? For we walk by faith and not by sight. Church, we don't need to see to believe. Our friends, our family, our relatives, all those that might be suffering right now, they don't have to see to believe. The purpose for us is to tell them, because that's all they can do is hear right now. Spiritual ears are open. They're going to hear it. Their physical ears are going to hear it. If that heart's tilled up, they're going to hear it in their spirit, and that's where the life-changing events happen. So I encourage you, this message right here is good for all of us. Sometimes our faith is tested from day in and day out. Sometimes we really wonder, man, gosh, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know where I'm going to get this from.
Come on.
I don't know how my mom's going to get this.
That's right.
No offense, Mom, I know you're not sick, but you get what I'm getting at. You pray for God, like, why aren't you listening? Why is that not happening? How many times have people done that? I mean, I've done it. That's where your faith gets tested.
Yes.
And that's where you go back and rely on Jesus Christ. You go back to his word. You go back to praying, realizing that he is your Father.
Yes.
He does not want you to have, he does not want you to be hurt. He doesn't want you to have, you know, the serpent. He doesn't want you to have a stone. He wants to give you exactly what you need to survive in this life for one, but also to do his work as his imagers, as the people that he created. Amen. So I'm going to ask you all to stand. So I'm going to ask these questions because this hit me on Sunday coming to church. And I thought it would be a good time to put it in this sermon. And we're going to listen to a song, I believe, of healing, right? That's on there. I want you to think, it's not only physical healing that Jesus came for. It was also that spiritual healing that we're talking about, that spiritual blindness. So if you have that, I just ask you to search in your heart about Jesus, about God. Is he your Savior? Is there a stronghold in your life? Is there something that's constantly holding you back from coming to Jesus? coming to Him fully, coming to Him in complete loyalty to Him. Because you see, God pursued you.
Amen.
God came down for each and every man, woman, and child to save them from eternal damnation, to grant them eternal life forever and ever and ever. There's no more crying. There's no more suffering for those that believe in Him. This is what makes Christianity different. Our God came for us. He came down to die for us. He knew that we needed a way out. And what was going on was not going to cut it because we were so screwed up. He said, I'm going to go down there and I'm going to make it right once and for all. And He did that.
Amen.
So will you pursue Him just like He pursued you? He loved you even when you didn't love Him.
Yes.
He died on the cross even while we were still sinning, yet Christ died for us.
Yes, yes.
He didn't care. He knew you were going to be screwing up. He knew somebody wasn't going to accept His message. He said, I don't care. I'm going for them. No matter what. I'm going to show them what it is. And that I am perfect. And I give them love. So will you pursue Him to be His imager? To be like Him? And you think about Israel in slavery. They go out of slavery. They have a little bit of faith to get out. Faith gets tested at the waters of the Red Sea. The waters are parted. They go to the Promised Land. And I say that because I don't want you to feel like you got to clean yourself up now. The Israelites got the commandment after they went into the wilderness. They had faith before they even got to the wilderness.
Yes, yes.
So your faith now doesn't clean up all the filthiness that you might have a stronghold on. Jesus wipes away all of our sins when we believe in Him and have faith in Him. There are times where people struggle. We see it time and time again. Even the disciples fail sometimes. And they believed in Him. They saw Him. They knew what was going on.
Yes.
So when you have those strongholds, church, even us that are believers, sometimes we screw up. But it's okay because we can go back to Father and say, God, I messed up.
Yes, amen.
Wipe me clean. Keep my mind focused on You. Keep my loyalty to
Yes.
You.
Yes.
And remember that. It took the Israelites faith first before they even got lost. And all it takes is faith. All it takes is faith. So I ask this to say, does any of that pertain to you? And if it does, I'll encourage you to come down. Or church, if you know anybody that is suffering, that you know that needs that comfort, that love, and that peace and joy, I ask you, come to pray for them. Because that's what we're here to do. We're here to be imagers, to be like God, to show the love and peace to a world that is dying and lost.
Yes,
amen. So I'm going to ask you all to come and pray while Sister Terry plays our song.
Thank you.